Let's talk about a couple of the Americans, Phil, that are applying their trade in the championship this particular season. You got Brendan Aaronson, who you mentioned, came off the bench to score the game-tying goal. Had a chance to score the winner, and he pushed it wide. Oh, my God, Brendan Aaronson. So you're like half a hero. You were almost there to being the great of all time. You got Aiden Morris, who made the move from the Columbus Crew, got the start for Michael Carrick's Middlesbrough. This past, they won 1-0, and I was pleasantly surprised to see him anchoring that midfield for Michael Carrick. That was great. Austin Trusties with Sheffield United. Got Josh Sargent, started the number 9 for Norwich. For me, surprisingly lost to Oxford, who just got promoted 2-0 to start the season. Haji Wright with Coventry, they lost 1-0. Then Ethan Horvath is at Cardiff. Of those players, there's others, but of those players, which one do you think, or which couple of them do you think are really going to stand out this year for their respective clubs?
Well, I thought two players had tremendous seasons last year in Haji Wright at Coventry. Missed out on the championship playoffs, but obviously had that incredible run in the FA Cup, getting so close to knocking Manchester United out in the semi-final, so close to the final. And I think that eventually did derail their season. You saw their fortunes taper off at the back end of the season when they ought to have been coming good. But he had a very strong season, first in the championship. And he's had a curious career, hasn't he, the countries he's played in. But he's Coventry put an awful lot of faith in him. They saw Victor Gyökeres the last summer, needed attacking reinforcements, went and signed Wright. And he did a job. He did a very good job. And I'll be fascinated to see how he does in his second season, because of all the teams that don't have parachute payments, of all the teams that are facing the crowd, so to speak, Coventry, to me, would be the one that would come close. They lost the playoff final 15 months ago when Luton went up. They came very close last year. Mark Robbins, excellent manager. And I think a full season with fortune on their side, I think Coventry will come very close. And the other one I would flag just for how good he was last season was Josh Sargent at Norwich. Tremendous figures, best of his career. And I was fully expecting him to leave Norwich this summer, if I'm honest. I thought there'd be options on the table for him because of the form he produced last year. Hasn't quite happened, and started the game on Saturday. And I was going to say that the championship and its capacity to surprise goes on and on every year. And you saw Norwich lose the championship playoffs semi-finals to Leeds last year. Their first game the next season, they lose to a team promoted out of League One. And by all accounts, they were pretty meek, pretty timid, and Oxford United were worthy winners there. Obviously, Josh Sargent, they have a great start to the season, but the form he showed last year, I would have every faith in him backing that up again.
Phil, really quick about Norwich. Because they lost Gabriel Sara to Galatasaray in Turkey, I mean, he was a playmaker for them, right? I mean, I thought he could help unlock getting Josh into good areas, right? And have they replaced that type of playmaking ability from Sara to get Josh that service? Because I think that's loss for Norwich.
Yeah, well, I think the biggest shift you'll see in Norwich this season is tactically. Last year under David Wagner, they were quite pragmatic. They weren't great to watch, I didn't think, a lot of the time. Wagner obviously had huge success with Huddersfield when he took them up to the Premier League not so long ago. They've gone in a different direction this year. Thorup, who's an unproven coach from Denmark, I think it's going to be a lot more entertaining, you'll see a lot more of the high press. There's going to be intensity. But I guess it's a bit of a leap of faith with Norwich. They went with the experience of Wagner to the inexperience in this case. He's 35. He's not managed in the championship before. So it's a bit of a leap of faith. But the interesting one with Norwich as well is that how they end the transfer window now, because they've had a change of ownership today ratified. More American owners in the EFL. Goodness knows how many we're up to now. Must be half, I'm sure.
But we know, yeah, you love it, Phil. It's okay. You can say you love it.
as long as Norwich strengthen in these final 2.5 weeks of the window, I could see them being competitive at the top end for sure.
Yeah, I hope so, because against Oxford over the weekend, Oxford looked like the team that had been in the championship for a much longer period than Norwich. Norwich didn't really create anything. It was an impressive performance from Oxford. So hopefully Norwich is able to figure that out. Now, I'm going to move on to sort of the relegation side, Phil. And we've talked all about the possibilities of going up. Who do you think's in trouble and why? Because of what they've done during the summer?
I think there's a whole lot of clubs in trouble. I would say ordinarily the teams that come up out of League One will be the ones that struggle. This year, I'm not so sure. You saw Portsmouth, you know, a club with a rich heritage, big fan base. They came up. You saw Derby County. Everything I just said about Portsmouth, you can attach to Derby as well. A club reborn, really, after their financial troubles not so long ago. And then Oxford. I would still expect Oxford to struggle, if I'm perfectly honest. I know they had a good opening day result against Norwich, but just because of their resources, they've got a stadium. I think the capacity is around 12,000. It's going to be difficult for them. They're not familiar with this level. We've got a rookie manager who shares my surname in Des Buckingham, but no relation, I must stress. I'm not about to big him up just because of his surname. But I think it'll be difficult for Oxford. But you can apply this to quite a few clubs. There's a few clubs that have flirted with the top half of the Championship, but generally found it difficult making that next step. And I would put in a team like Preston, who we've seen part with their manager after one game of the season. They've parted company with Ryan Lowe today. I think they might struggle towards the bottom end.
Don't tell me that.
I know. I'm sorry, Ryan, but I think they've punched above their weight for a lot of years, given their resources. And it wouldn't surprise me even last year, they were comfortable mid-table in the end. But if you took away their starts of the season, where it was the first 6-8 weeks where they were brilliant, right up at the top end of the table, if you took those away from them, they would have been down the bottom. And that's kind of the reason Ryan Lowe's left, I'm sure. He was a bit of friction between him and the fan base. And who else have we got? I think if you want to stretch it further, there's a team that might come from nowhere in the sort of relegation shakeup. Watford weren't too long ago were a Premier League team, and I think if you look at their recruitment or more alarmingly the players they've let go in the last few months, in the last 18 months, they've really regressed as a club since they came out of the Premier League. And we talked about this earlier, that the teams that come out of the Premier League should be at such an advantage with a financial backing that they have in parachute payments, compared to a team that hasn't been in the Premier League in the last 3 years. Watford probably had 3-4 times the income, and they've really made a mess of it back in the Championship. And all of a sudden, they're just another face in the crowd. And I think there's every chance you'll see them struggle. But as I say, I'm not dodging the question here, but because of the three teams that came up, I think you could make a case for 10 of the Championship teams to go down.
Yeah, it speaks to that.
And I would add that come March the 1st, when we enter the last 2 months of the season, I think you could probably say the same then, because I don't think there'll be any teams cut adrift, and I think there'll be quite a few clubs sweating by that point.
All right. Well, I'm glad that EFL and Championship in particular is on the Golasso Network and Paramount Plus. That's very exciting, everybody. I want to talk about Aiden Morris, though. Makes the big move, as I mentioned before, from Columbus Crew, the reigning MLS Cup champions, to Middlesbrough. He starts in the middle of midfield for Michael Carrick. What are you hearing about him? And obviously that's a big deal for him to come into the team that was already really strong and finding his way into the starting 11 to start the season.
Well, it's a big move for him, and it's a big move for Middlesbrough as well. It's not often they spend that type of money in their recruitment. So it's a show of faith in him and a trusted on the opening day of the season. They put him straight into the team, and by all accounts, man of the match as well. So he's had a flying start there. What I would say about Middlesbrough is chances are it'll be a good place for him to develop. If you look at Middlesbrough's model in the last 2 to 3 years, they've signed players around his age, 22, 23, 24, for similar types of money, about 2-4 million. And they've developed these players into Premier League players. I can give you, well, not Premier League, but Tuber Akpom sold on to Ajax. You've got Morgan Rogers straight back to Aston Villa. After 6 months in the Championship with Middlesbrough, Tavernier now at Bournemouth, they've developed players and moved them on for a good profit. Deals that have worked for Middlesbrough and deals that have worked for the player as well. And in Michael Carrick, you aren't going to find many better Premier League players to look up to if you're a holding midfielder, right? I know he's a coach now, but you saw what he did in his career. And if he can't teach Aidan Morris a trick or two, something's gone horribly wrong, I'm sure. But Michael Carrick's done a really good job at Middlesbrough in the last year, for sure. Unfortunate to just fall short in the playoffs. If they hadn't had such a bad start, I'm sure they would have been a top six team last year.
Yeah, and I think they're going up. I mean, the brand of soccer that Michael puts out is fun to watch. And if anybody that's seen Aidan Morris play for the Columbus Crew, and I know you got Darlington Nagbe, who is, you know, I don't know if you've ever seen him play, Phil. The two of them, you could throw the ball at their feet, and they could keep it in a 5-yard square with five people in it. It's impressive. Right. So really appreciate your insight. Is there something that we should keep an eye on that we don't know about that you think is worthy to mention?
Yeah, have you heard of a team called Wrexham?
I joke. That's all we hear about.
I joke. No, if I was to give you a dark horse for this season, a team that just stayed up on the final day of last season would be Sheffield Wednesday for me. Not because they thumped Plymouth yesterday, but because of Danny Rowland, manager in charge. He was outstanding last year. He arrived at Sheffield Wednesday. I think they had a couple of points after a dozen games. Looked absolutely nailed on for relegation back to League One. They were a shambles. But the job he did in two-thirds of the season to keep them up as he did, I fully expected him to leave Sheffield Wednesday this summer. That's how good a job he did. I thought someone would come in and poach him. Mid-30s German coach, did an amazing job last year. And Sheffield Wednesday is a club with an enormous capacity for chaos under their owner, Chancery. Unpopular fans, but he's managed to convince Danny Rowe that he should stay there. And he's just picked up where they left off at the back end of last season. Thumped Wayne Rooney's Plymouth Argyle 4-0 yesterday.
That was, it was crazy.
Awful
start was, and how good Sheffield was.
Awful start for Wayne Rooney, obviously. But to me, the story yesterday was Danny Rowland, the thing he's got going at Hillsborough, because Sheffield Wednesday. I shouldn't confuse the two, for sure. Sheffield Wednesday are an enormous club with a huge fan base, and if that club gets on a roll this season, and if he is backed in the next 2.5 weeks in the transfer window, I can see them being a top 16 for sure.
Oh, wow. That's something to keep an eye on for sure. I love that question, McBrizzle. That was a good one. And we appreciate your time, Phil. Make sure you drop him a follow at PJ Buckingham on Twitter. We appreciate all the work you're doing on The Athletic as well. Last question from us. It's about Gaga Slonina, who is getting a loan move from Chelsea, which is not a surprise because I think they loan out about 1,000 players every year. But he's going to Barnsley. And so we're all very curious as to, will he start? We want one of our top young goalkeepers to get as many minutes as possible, which he got in Belgium last year, but this feels like a bit of a step up and a different type of pressure now that he's in the EFL. What are your thoughts on Slonina making the move, and will he get those minutes between the sticks for Barnsley?
I'm certain he'll start. I don't think Chelsea sanction this move. I don't think Barnsley get this type of deal without some sort of assurance that he's going to be their number one for the season. I'm absolutely convinced he will. Big move for him. You mentioned his time in Belgium last year was difficult at times. And this is going to be a good test. It's League One. It's below the Championship. But if you look at Barnsley's pedigree in the last 10 years, if they're not fighting relegation from the Championship, they're pushing for promotion in League One. So last 2 years, they've been in the League One playoffs. And we saw in Daryl Dike, he was there at Barnsley 2-3 years ago, was it? Before he made the move to West Brom, before all his terrible injuries. He had huge success at Barnsley, and it'll be a really good grounding for him, a chance for him to play regular football. It's a physical league, so it'll be good for his development in terms of bringing that side of his game on. I do think Barnsley will find it more difficult than they did last year. We saw some big teams come out of the Championship in Birmingham City and Huddersfield. American owners will throw money up to get back to the Championship, I'm sure. The money that Birmingham City has spent this summer is eye-watering at that level. So Barnsley will find it difficult. We mentioned Wrexham. There's the usual suspects. There's Bolton. it's Peterborough United. But Barnsley's pedigree says they'll be a top 10 team for sure. And with the opportunity to play football as he has, I think it'll be a really good move for him.
Well, I hope so. From your lips to the soccer gods' ears, Phil, thank you so much for your time. We appreciate you. And we'll hope to have you back on the show very, very soon.